In this video today, we're going to talk about platelet-rich plasma, also known as PRP. What's the typical average cost?
I'm Dr. Orlando Landrum, a Harvard and Cornell-trained MD who specializes in interventional pain, regenerative medicine, and neuromodulation techniques. I've helped thousands of patients be able to get their lives back and eliminate their pain.
In this video today, we're going to talk about an option that has been gaining steam, but hasn't necessarily been defined in full depth and detail so that everyone can be able to understand. So PRP is formulated from blood. However, when we say PRP, frequently we think of an alphabet soup. Like there's a number of just different letters that are just constantly coming in. But PRP stands for platelet-rich plasma. And what happens in order to be able to acquire that plasma is that patients come into the office or into the clinic and they have their blood drawn through a sterile means that allows for us to be able to extract that blood to be able to utilize it to the patient's benefit and make decisions about how to go forward. So that blood is subsequently separated into different parts. It's different parts that we'll talk about in depth and detail in just a second or so, but parts that are sounding confusing because of all the different letters that are associated with them. And in particular, there's two types that are in place. One that is called leukocyte rich, and the second, which is called leukocyte poor. But the basic breakdown is one of a simplistic component called red PRP versus amber PRP. And red PRP is typically comprised of having some degree of leukocytes, which are white blood cells, as well as some components of red blood cells that are present. Amber PRP is typically leukocyte poor, meaning that it's lacking in white blood cells, and typically it's lacking in red blood cells. So how does that really come to pass? Well, I'm glad you asked. So when we take a look at the different types of PRP, there are components that look at pure platelet composition, that look at fibrin composition, as well as those that look at leukocyte composition. So when you take a look at the picture on the far right, one of the things that you'll see is that it has the structure of blood listed. And that structure of blood basically shows that there's plasma, there's blood cells, and then there's red blood cells. And with centrifugation, meaning the spinning, those cells can be separated out into different parts. So traditionally, as you can see, the one tube has whole blood all mixed together, and then there's a spin that takes place, and you have a separation into PRP, or platelet-rich plasma. And that thin layer, you have the composition of cells. And that bottom layer, you have a concentrated platelets and white blood cells. Then you have another subsequent spin, which is able to then further isolate the elements of the plasma and those concentrated cells different than before. So when we look at a further breakdown, what we can see is that there's both leukocyte-rich plasma, there's leukocyte-poor plasma, and there's different compositions of having fibrin or not having fibrin, in addition to having poor platelets. So those are the four different types of PRP that can be utilized. So this slide kind of goes into a little bit further depth of when fibrin is present, what does that really mean in terms of activation, and how that can potentially not be utilized in injectable form, but typically is more of a kind of be an activated gel. So as you can kind of see, that number one is platelet rich, leukocyte poor, and it has low fiber, so it can be used as a liquid solution. Number two is one that has pure platelet rich, but it also has, it's rich in fibrin, and it's leukocyte poor, but it's rich in fibrin. So in that context, it's strongly activated. It's traditionally not used as an injectate. It's used more like a traditional fibrin glue. Number three is leukocyte and platelet rich. In this context, it has both white blood cells as well as red blood cells, but a low amount of fibrin, and it can be used as an injectate component.
And then fourth would be leukocyte and platelet rich with the aspect of fibrin, which in that context is typically going to be more gel-like and not going to be as likely to be a traditional injectate. So when you break those different types down, how does it really work? Well, how it works is the following. Is so if you take a look, those different aspects on this key, there's whole blood in blue, leukocyte poor in red, leukocyte rich PRP in green, and then purple is platelet poor plasma. So when we take a look at these different growth factors, which we'll get into more depth and detail in just a second or so, we can see that the growth factor release is pretty prominent for leukocyte rich. And also when we look at the stimulation of tendon cell proliferation, meaning so those cells that are important in terms of formulating tendons in your shoulder and your knee and really being able to see some degree of change, again, it appears that the elements of leukocyte-rich PRP seem to be kind of taking the lead in terms of success. However, there are contexts and studies that have been shown that those utilizations of leukocyte-rich sometimes result in a pro-inflammatory process and increased release of cytokines, and leukocyte-poor doesn't have that same type of downside. In addition, leukocyte-poor has been shown to have an increase in the activation of chondrocytes, which are cells that are important for cartilage. And so in that context, it can be incredibly useful for different areas that have low cartilage, whether it's the aspect of a shoulder or knee or hip, it can be utilized to be able to provide some degree of benefit. So how does it work? Well, this PRP results in platelet activation, which then influences a number of different factors. And those factors have a bit of a breakdown that can result in a number of things. So the first is platelet-derived growth factor. The second is vascular endothelial growth factor. The third is fibroblast growth factor, epithelial growth factor, and transforming growth factor, right? And so all those type of things can have impacts on the repair and regeneration of blood vessels, the proliferation of vascular cells, the proliferation of epithelial cells, the increased improvement in terms of wound healing. So that's what PRP, it utilizes kind of these secondary mediators to be able to help improve healing. So when we talk about this, we need to be clear, there's many more factors than what is currently mentioned, and there's an interplay that certainly takes place that influences healing in different ways. So, to that context, what are some of the specific medical conditions that can be treated with PRP? The spine can be treated, in particular the elements of the SI joints, facet joints, and if needed, potentially the disc. The shoulder for partial rotator cuff tears are able to have some degree of benefit. Osteoarthritis of the knee, depending on the severity of the arthritis. And tennis elbow has been shown to be more efficaciously treated with the use of PRP versus steroid. And there have been a number of studies that have taken a look and assessed the knee, the foot, the tendon of the Achilles, the aspect of the elbow, as well as the shoulder, and has given some understanding about the true strength of that information. Generalized pricing in the past, and back in 2009, was somewhere from $500 to $2,000. As we see more studies that have shown improved efficacy, that price has increased from $1,500 to $3,500 on average for a traditional injection. So when we take a look at those costs, we see that there are certain things that are in place with how one looks at the elements of ligaments and tendon tears and what makes sense for using PRP and what doesn't make sense and may need to use another type of orthobiologic. If you have questions about platelet-rich plasma that weren't covered in this talk, by all means, go to our website and download our guide, which will give you further information and further insight about how to be able to improve your condition and how to use PRP as a successful treatment option that can be able to help you for some of the things that you are faced with.
If you like this video, please hit the subscribe button and also give us a comment on the question of the day. Continue to look out for other videos that really help empower patients and give understanding about technology and treatment options that help patients get their lives back and be able to eliminate their pain. Thank you so much and have a great day.